Hey everybody, it is Nathan and Jess Selove.
And today we wanted to take a minute before we introduce the video to give a thank you to all essential workers. There is a lot of COVID-19 content out these days, especially on YouTube, and that's not the main focus of this video today, but we do just want to take the time to thank every person who is an essential worker who has to go out and go to work and put themselves at risk. We just really appreciate the work that you're doing.
Yeah, your sanitation workers, your people that work in grocery stores, your pharmacy workers, your people that work in restaurants. Everyone that's considered essential, you really are the heroes of this pandemic. And I especially want to send out a huge shout out to the people that are working in the medical profession right now. You are putting yourselves at risk every single day. You truly are heroes in this time. And I hope that my subscribers will feel free to leave comments down below, also thanking all of you that might be watching this video that work in the medical profession. So keep up the fight, and do not think that those of us who are quarantined at home and staying home have not noticed the sacrifice and the diligence that you have shown throughout this entire ordeal. All right, so today our video topic is going to be another one in which we're going to talk a little bit about romance and autism.
Yeah, Nathan has had several videos about our relationship and when we were dating and when we got married, and we do tend to specify our relationship because we say all the time, you've met one autistic, you've met one autistic.
Or in this case, you've met two autistics, because if you've met both of us, we're both autistics.
Nathan has even chronicled a lot of our relationship on his play, Odd Is Love.
Which is on YouTube, and you can go back and watch it if you haven't watched it before. Or if you have watched it before.
But in a strange turn of events, we kind of want to zoom out a little bit and look at relationships, and specifically romantic relationships, as a whole in a more general sense, and how that might be informed by an autistic person's perspective. Again, a lot of these thoughts and kind of the conversation around this could apply to neurotypical folks. But the reason that we are specifying for autistic folks is, one, this is an autism advocacy channel, and two, that growing up in the United States in this time period, you can get a lot of messages from different media, the way that our families and businesses are structured, about what a romantic relationship should look like, how it should begin, and how everything should just go through life until you get your happily ever after with a one single human. And we want to kind of poke at that a little bit and look underneath.
Yeah, I remember when I was in high school, I was certain that I was going to marry whoever my senior prom date was. And you know who my senior prom date was?
I do.
Sylvia. R.I.P. Love you.
So, before we can get into kind of a general talk about relationships, we'll just preface this by giving a slight background on our personal dating life. I was someone who did not date anyone seriously before I met Nathan. At about 22 years old, that's when I met Nathan. I had already decided by that point in my life that I probably wasn't going to have a romantic relationship. Or if I did, it was going to happen when I was 40 or 50. I don't know why. That's what I was wavering in between. I don't know why. So 40,
50, or never. Not 60, definitely not 30.
But I had just decided that relieved a lot of pressure because I had never wanted to date anyone before I met you.
Yeah.
And I had tried to force myself to date people, which is an experience a lot of people have had. I think especially autistics. I know that I learned a lot about how to pass by emulating behavior and speech of others. So I had been trying for so long to make my life fit what I thought it was supposed to, and I kind of thought I could fake it till I made it, and it didn't work out for me. Truly didn't. But Nathan, in contrast...
Yeah, so I had had quite a few relationships, and you probably know a little bit about that if you've already seen the Odd Is Love, which, you know, again, watch it if you haven't. And yeah, I have always been a hopeless romantic, and in a lot of those relationships, I was like, yes, this is definitely the one. It wasn't the other like 10 relationships that I was in before this one, but this one, this is going to be the one relationship to rule them all. And that kept not happening through middle school, through high school, through college. Yes, I did have relationships in middle school, if you want to count those. But yeah, so when I got to the point right before I met Jess, I was at this point where I had been single for the longest stretch that I'd ever been single. And I was starting to think, you know what? I just need to stop looking for a relationship. I just need to stop. And as soon as the day that I decided I was going to stop, and this is going to sound really cheesy, but the day I decided that, I actually met Jess. And it was crazy, but I gave her my number so she could call me maybe, but instead she called me Nathan.
That is such a dated joke.
Dated joke? Huh? Get it? Dated?
Yes.
Because we date, because okay. It's dated.
All of that brings up kind of the first point, which is that we get a lot of comments from our lovely viewers who say things like, I'll never find a relationship that nice, or I'll never find someone who loves me in spite of or because of my autism. Wow, wish I had a relationship like that, but I'm already this age and it's never happened and it never will, and I feel lonely. That person might be comfortable who's commenting, but it does kind of remind us a little bit of how we thought years ago. That is not an uncommon feeling. A lot of people, I think, especially maybe at any age, can feel like there's no one out there who understands them. That is why I really recommend developing deep platonic relationships. Like, support and mutual respect and affection can all be things you can gain from a good friendship. You know, that kind of brings us to one of the assumptions about relationships that we are fed through movies and TV and plays and interactions, which is that the romantic relationship is the one that you should always strive for.
Yeah.
And it is the be-all, end-all, and the only way for you to feel complete and full.
Yeah, it's kind of treated as a box to check, which is a little bit problematic. I mean, one thing that I kind of noticed with my own story was, like I said, when I stopped looking, that's when I found the right relationship. But it wasn't about finding a relationship. It was about finding a person that you can be friends with, that you consider yourself to be close with on a personal level, not just like, okay, so when I grow up, you know, got my house, check, got my TV, check, got my significant other, check. That's not how you should view it, because relationships are about individuals.
Mm-hmm. Because we kind of get that impression, especially for autistics who maybe learned how to mimic appropriate behavior from TV and movies and what they saw throughout life, that can leave you sort of struggling. This feeling of needing to have a romantic relationship and yet not having one, either because maybe you need more time to develop yourself. Maybe you just haven't met someone who would fit in well with your life, especially if you're an autistic like I am, where I don't like to meet a lot of new people. As Nathan said, we had both gotten to the point where we decided that we didn't need a romantic relationship in order to feel successful in our lives. That's important for anybody who is concerned about if they will have a romantic relationship. The first thing is to question, do you want one? How would you want it to look like? You should have these expectations before you start dating someone. I know for me, I wanted essentially a best friend that I got married to, and that's what I got. Also, you should consider vaguely what you're looking for. If you know, in the future, you want to get married, in the future, you want to have children, in the future, you want to move to a different country and live abroad for many years, or in the future, you want to travel a lot and you don't want to have a home base, in the future, you don't want to have any kind of ties to one community. Those are all things that, if you know that that's what you want in life, you really should start to talk with someone that you might be considering as a potential partner. You should find a way to work that into a conversation. Some people disagree about when that is too early. Nathan and I had the, hey, I want kids one day talk on our first date.
And it wasn't like, hey, we're going to have kids someday together.
I would like 2.5 children.
Yeah. It wasn't like that. It was just kind of, it came up in a conversation. Oh, I like doing this. I was like, yeah, I'm hoping to do that with one of my kids someday.
Hey. Casually, but it was on purpose.
It was on purpose, because
you want to screen. And he might have decided that we were going to have a more casual relationship. He might have decided that we just weren't going to be a good fit.
Yeah.
But that we worked for
us.
We could
be buds, you know? We could be bros.
We're not bros.
We're bros.
We're not bros.
Bro.
No.
Bro.
Put your fist down. Hey,
come on.
No.
Don't leave me hanging. Jess just told a joke that we had to cut because it was too inappropriate.
Because as Nathan said, you might end up getting into a relationship with someone that you like, that they like you, but you're not compatible, or they maybe don't treat you the way you want to be treated.
That's happened to me several times.
Or you just might not realize that it's okay to be alone with yourself and focus on your goals in life. You can focus on what you want to do. There's a certain freedom in that, and it's really important to celebrate that when you have it. Yeah. And that doesn't mean that you're wrong for wanting someone. You shouldn't feel ashamed of that, but you should think about how you can want that while also still appreciating where you are in your life, and don't use it as another reason to beat yourself up. So to any of the viewers out there who have said things like, I'll never find someone who likes my quirks or likes my autism, that's not necessarily true. I can't make a blanket statement that there is someone out there who's going to love everything you do. That's probably not true. I don't love everything Nathan does. And what? He doesn't love everything I do. What? I watch HGTV a lot, and Nathan hates it. If you are someone who is finding that you cannot connect with people, one, I would, as I usually do, advocate for therapy. If you have access to it, if you can find a therapist that you trust, that you have a good rapport with, hopefully one informed about autism and how it manifests itself, especially if you're an adult. But if you don't have access to that and you have friends that you trust and you trust their judgment and think, this is a good person, this is a person that I would like to behave like more in the future, you could say something like, I've noticed that I want to date people and something is happening when I'm approaching them or after we've had a date or wherever the system is breaking down. And I wondered if you've ever noticed anything. Be prepared to listen and not get defensive. I say that because autistics can often be defensive and not know they're being defensive.
What are you talking about? For example, I sometimes had some behaviors that were a little bit off-putting to some other people. Like, not like morally reprehensible or anything, but just like inappropriate. So that's very common. But people really shouldn't view relationships as being something that the world owes to you.
Mm-hmm.
Because relationships are always two-way streets, or sometimes three-way streets if you're into that sort of thing.
Or more.
And you really need to think of it as, not that you should change who you are, but there might be some behaviors that you might need to adjust a little bit in order to make people feel more comfortable. And there might be some behaviors that a significant other might need to change for you to make you feel more comfortable. Because that's what it means to be in interpersonal relationships. I hope that this video has given you some sort of roadmap, some more understanding about relationships in general, and I hope that it's made you feel a little bit more comfortable about your own situation, regardless of what your situation happens to be.
And if nothing else, I hope that you know that there's nothing wrong with you necessarily just because you're not dating anyone, especially if you don't want to date anyone. That's all stuff there is always time to figure out. Even if you're 40 or 70, there are plenty of people who will tell you, older than us, that they found really good partners at a much higher age than, 23 and 20.
Well, that's today's video. Thank you all for watching. If you liked this video, please give it a like, a share, and if you haven't already, subscribe to the channel. Check out some of my other stuff. And if you want to support the channel in other ways, support me on Patreon. And you will see me in the next one.